everybody. Welcome to the webinar. It seems a shame to actually cut off that amazing guitar solo, but we have a lot to discuss. And so we'll go ahead and get started. Thanks for joining us today. My name is Alison O'Connor, and I'm with Larimer County Extension. I'm joined with Tony Koski, who is our Extension Turfgrass Specialist, and Amy Lentz, who is behind the scenes doing questions for us today. So we welcome you to the webinar, and we just want to let you know that this webinar is being recorded, and I will make sure I put on the translations for you as well. And okay, I went ahead and did that. So this will be recorded. If you registered with us, you will get a recording of the link once it's ready. We'll be sure to post that to YouTube. We'll also put it on the cohort's blog website. And in the email that we send out with the link, we'll also include any handouts that might be pertinent to today's talk. So if you need to leave us, don't you worry. You can catch up with us another time. And we do want to remind you that CSU is an equal opportunity university. If you need access, if you need any accommodations, please reach out to us and we'll be sure to provide those to you. Amy can put our emails into the chat if that's something that you would like to chat with us more about, or if you need some more information. So today's topic is a 2022 gardening year in review. We are going to cover what happened in the gardens, what happened in the landscape, and talk about maybe some things that can occupy your time as we get into the colder months of Colorado and into the winter. So as I said, Tony and I will be your co-hosts today, and Tony will start us off with turf, but I first wanted to let you know that Extension is the outreach arm of your land-grant institution, which is Colorado State University. And we have topics on so many different things, including financial management, food preservation, and safety. So with a big holiday coming up at the end of the month, if you're not sure how to safely defrost your turkey, please call your local Extension office. It's not a good idea to look online and get some recommendations there. There is a safe way to do that. We also have 4-H youth development and also, of course, agriculture and natural resources. So wherever you are in Colorado, we are local, so be sure to contact your local Extension office. Looking ahead to what we're going to talk about today, the issues we saw in 2022, we had a really tough year for lawns, especially in the spring. So Tony will cover what caused that and what you can prevent it from doing to your lawn this winter. We'll talk a little bit about sprinklers. We'll talk about heat effects on vegetables because we had a scorching hot summer, especially if you were down here in the Front Range. Some ips, beetles, grasshoppers, and then we'll wrap up with really, I think, what was the best fall year, fall color year ever. So with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Tony.
Cool. Well, welcome everyone. Thanks for being here. And we'll just quickly go through some lawn issues we saw in this past year. And I love this picture because this is Allison's front yard and she's a lawn geek. Usually her lawn is perfect. It's got stripes, it's green, it's uniform, no weeds. So this shows that even the very best turf managers had problems with turf potentially coming out of winter this last spring. So if it can happen to Allison, it can happen to anyone. So what happened with some of our lawns over this past winter, and how can you maybe prevent the same thing from happening this year? And of course, we can't really predict what the winter is gonna be like, but if you remember last winter, we had warm, and then we had bouts of very cold temperatures. And then one thing that was missing quite a bit was any kind of snow cover. So when we do have really cold temperatures and it's sunny and it's windy and it's not very humid and we don't have snow cover, we can have a number of landscape problems, turf problems. And sometimes those can be quite severe. So we'll look at these four major causes of some of our turf problems from this last year. The first one would be what I call freeze drying or winter desiccation. And this is what happens when quite simply the turf that is dormant and would normally survive cold, dry conditions, when it is subjected to really, really dry, cold conditions, any moisture that's left in that plant gets basically sucked out of it. And that plant that once was dormant is now dead. It's hard to tell the difference between dormant and dead turf, though, coming out of spring, until you get into like March and April, and parts of your lawn are greening up and other parts aren't. And that's almost really, unfortunately, one way to diagnose winter desiccation injury. Now, what sometimes is done on golf courses where you're kind of monitoring the turf for that, and you've maybe had that problem in the past, is people will take samples out of their lawn and bring them into a warm place like their office or a little greenhouse or something like that, and then warm the turf up and see if it grows. And you know, really, what can you do to guard against this? And this would be watering as late as you can into the fall. You know, whether that be just delaying, you know, blowing out your irrigation systems. Now we got some really cold weather coming, so hopefully you've had your systems blown out. But before that, hopefully you were doing some winter watering of your landscapes, which is good not only for the turf but also for those trees and shrubs that are growing in your landscape as well. So watering late into the year, and then when we get those few days in maybe December, January, February, where it might be warm for a couple days, and you can get that hose and a sprinkler out and pull it around, especially to those south and west facing really dry parts of a lawn, and just run a sprinkler for a few hours. Just one or two days a month can go a long ways towards preventing this type of problem. So now the other thing here is, in this picture, you can see there was some really severe irrigation coverage problems in this lawn. So whenever you can see those irrigation, where those irrigation heads are coming out of winter, that demonstrates that this really is an irrigation. This is a water problem. So you can see where the turf around those irrigation heads is greener. That's because it got a little bit more water than the rest of the lawn. So this is also an indicator that you should be doing some repair and some maintenance and fine tuning of that irrigation system the upcoming year. So water as much as you can, and you're able this winter. Next slide. Another problem that we saw, and this kind of went back to last fall, we had a lot of this insect called cranberry girdler, which is it's a larva from little white moths that fly around in your yard in the late summer and early fall. They lay eggs, those eggs hatch, and you get these little tiny subterranean caterpillars. These things, they feed on roots, not on the leaves of the grass, and they're like underground lawnmowers. And so that turf may not show symptoms going into winter that it's had some feeding damage, but then that very dry winter kind of finishes the turf off what those caterpillars started. The other thing is, we're finding that these insects can they overwinter in the larval form, and then they may actually do some feeding in the spring as well. So sometimes we see a little bit of spring damage from these cranberry girdler. These things are so cyclical. You can never predict them from one year to the next. And if you really want to be sure, especially if you've had cranberry girdler in the past, or white grubs, or if you're in the part of the state where you have Japanese beetle, using the insecticide acelaprin that the spot sells as Grubex, you can put this material down in late May into like early mid-June, and it will control white grubs and probably do a pretty good job of controlling cranberry girdler into the fall. And that's a very pollinator, people, bird, animal, wildlife safe insecticide. It's different from other insecticides that perhaps you've been used to using in the past. It's a very environmentally friendly product for specifically for controlling the soil inhabiting insects in lawns. So that's it's good insurance. It's not necessarily inexpensive, but it lasts a long time, and again, very environmentally safe. Okay, next slide. Now we often lump this with insect problems, but turf grass mites are really caused by this organism. It has eight legs, so more closely related to spiders. And this shows a lawn. This is very typical mite injury, a southwest facing lawn. Those parts of your landscape dry out more quickly and more thoroughly in a winter when we don't have good snow cover and we don't have precipitation. And these are the places that mites love. So mites, they're not a problem during the summer or even in the fall, although their eggs hatch in the fall. And you may see a little mite activity this time of year, but not enough to cause this type of damage. But during the winter and late winter, early spring months, their populations can double every 1 or 2 days. And what they do is they suck the life out of the plant. They're like little plant vampires, and they suck all the moisture and goodies, sugars, and everything out of the plant, and that plant will often die. And so one way to tell that you have mites is to do, and I saw a note flash by something called doing the wipe test. If you suspect that you have mites, and these things are really hard to see, is just take a piece of white paper and swipe it across that part of the lawn where you suspect you might have mites, and you'll see these little brown and reddish and orange streaks on the paper. And that's where you've crushed their little mite bodies. So that's an indication that you do have mites. And it's also an indication that you should really start watering that turf as much as you can immediately. Mites do not like moisture. So when we have winters where we have a lot of snow and snow cover, we don't see mite problems in the spring. It's those very open, dry, sunny, windy winters, which is what we had last winter. And that really increased the potential for mite problems in lawns. So here's the problem is this injury looks very much, in some ways it's identical in some ways to winter desiccation. It's the plant having all the moisture sucked out of it. In one way, it's the climate doing it. In other instances, it's these little mites feeding that are doing it. And a lot of times, it's a combination of both. So in some of these lawns, it was hard to tell and hard to separate what was winter desiccation, what was caused by the mites feeding. And in the end, the real cause was the same. It was just too dry, and these very susceptible parts of these landscapes didn't get enough water. If you're thinking, well, maybe this was cranberry girdler. Well, cranberry girdler, because it feeds on roots, you can pull chunks of turf up very easily. But with mites, the turf is still very anchored into the soil. Same thing with winter desiccation. The turf does not pull up easily. So that doing what we call the tug test is a good diagnostic tool for checking for cranberry girdler or maybe grub feeding. That may have happened in the fall as well. So again, the solution here is winter watering as much as you can, especially if you've had a history of mites in your landscape. Okay, the next one is rabbits. So rabbits are active all year round, and they do cause turf damage in the active growing part of the season. But because rabbits are hungry all year round, they have to eat. Some of their feeding can really be accentuated, and the damage they cause can be accentuated by this winter long feeding that they do. So if you do have rabbits in your landscape, the problem just becomes worse and more concentrated over the winter. This is a combination of feeding, but also their urine can be very damaging to the turf. And then if you have a dog that likes to mark over the spots where the rabbits are feeding, and some dogs will do this, then you're doubling the damage. You get dog urine damage on top of rabbit damage, and that can cause some really large areas of your lawn to die over the winter. So you know, the best way to deal with rabbits is to exclude them, and that requires putting fencing and basically hardware cloth, very small mesh fencing to exclude them from your yard. Another thing that you can do is to apply milorganite fertilizer, which is a repellent. Milorganite is a sewage-based fertilizer. They don't like the smell of this. And so applying it to your lawn and to your landscape beds where a lot of times the rabbits are hiding under junipers. Same thing with voles. If you've had vole damage in the spring, voles don't like this milorganite. So this applying milorganite to your landscape this time of year can prevent a lot of animal damage. And I was just having a conversation with my students about an hour ago that this is what superintendents do on their golf courses up in the mountains in the spring before it snows. This time of year, they put a lot of milorganite out around the borders of the course where the native grasses meet up with their mowed grass. And that band of milorganite can keep those voles from venturing out into the turf and damaging it under snowfall during the winter. So takes a multi-pronged approach to managing rabbits in the landscape. Okay, what's next here? Again, many of our winter into spring problems last year were the result of poor irrigation coverage from the previous year. So when you have poor sprinkler coverage going into fall and into winter, that turf is under more stress than turf that has uniform irrigation coverage. So many of our problems in the winter, in the spring, during the summer, are very much water related. And people always say, well, I know it's not water. They send pictures all the time, like this lawn. And this was a classic one. The email came and immediately they say, we know it's not a water problem because the sprinklers pop up. This is a water problem. This is either not enough, poor coverage, poor pressure, poor uniformity, but you can see where the sprinkler heads are. And this is due to the fact partially that there's no check valves in these sprinkler heads. So when the system does go off, those the lines drain to those heads and that leaks out around the heads. And that's why the turf is nice and green there. But this should be a clue that the majority of the lawn is not getting enough irrigation. So this causes stress at all times of the year, not just in the summer, but also in the spring, in the fall, in the winter. Poor irrigation coverage is a definite cause of all kinds of stress and really inadvertently or indirectly a cause of some of our pest problems, like oftentimes mite problems and rabbit problems can be more severe where sprinkler coverage is not encouraging turf recovery. And many of our turf diseases are more severe because of sprinkler coverage problems. So doing an irrigation audit is, at least it'll convince you that really it is a sprinkler coverage problem. So how do you do an irrigation audit? That's the next slide, I think. Here we go, irrigation audit. So you're gonna get something when we send out the email to everyone listening online. You'll get a fact sheet that we have on how to do an irrigation audit. But this is how you convince yourself that maybe your sprinkler coverage is not as good as you think. You can't eyeball sprinkler coverage unless your lawn is really, really bad or your irrigation system is. But usually it's hard to tell by running the sprinkler system if you've got irrigation coverage problems. So this is a way to do it. You put some containers out on the lawn. A lot of times people will send me pictures of their lawn and say, what's the problem with my lawn? And I will put little stars on the picture. I send it back to them and I say, do me a favor. And this is one I actually did this with this summer. And again, they were debating, well, arguing with me. They knew for a fact, absolutely, it's not sprinkler problem because their irrigation person told them so. And I said, well, your irrigation person is wrong. This is an irrigation problem. I said, do me a favor, put some containers on these spots, run your system, measure the depth of water with a ruler, and then email me back and tell me, is the same amount of water in each one of these, or is it different? And they very sheepishly, but honestly said, you were right. And this is just classic irrigation coverage problems. And a lot of times you see it on the edges of driveways like this, or the edges of sidewalks. But sometimes heads don't come up in the middle of a lawn. So there's all kinds of reasons that we have sprinkler coverage problems. But doing this audit is at least a way for you to kind of pinpoint maybe where that problem is. And it could be that head right there in the corner where the sidewalk and the driveway come together. I'm guessing that that head on the corner of that landscape, it's not coming up at all. Something's not right with that head. And at least it gives you some direction on where to start looking at sprinkler issues in your lawn. Okay, next slide I think shows how do we diagnose these brown spots? And this is just kind of step-by-step. This isn't rocket science, but Alison and I wrote this because it's almost like daily during the summer, we're getting questions and pictures from people, what's wrong with my lawn? If it's a dry, hot summer, which is what we did have. We had really high temperatures and we didn't have a lot of rain, and that reveals irrigation coverage problems in your lawn. And this is how you convince yourself that it is indeed your irrigation system. So look for this in our email to you in a few days. So one of the problems that leads or is the result of poor irrigation problems is this very common disease in lawns, kind of when we go in the spring into the summer period, when we kind of go from cool, maybe cloudy, maybe a little bit rainy weather, and then it's instantly summer and it's 80, 85, 90 degree temperatures. We get this disease called ascochyta leaf blight. And this shows up, again, almost always. It's because people haven't started their irrigation system, or they haven't checked for irrigation coverage problems, or they're not running it long enough. Something is just not right with their irrigation in that lawn, and this disease starts to pop up, and it looks horrible. It looks like the turf is dead, and then people want to resod, they want to reseed, they want to blame their mowing company for bringing this disease onto the lawn, and that's not the case. The fungus that causes this, the spores that cause this disease, are in every lawn in the state of Colorado. It is not brought onto your lawn by mowing. It can be made worse by mowing, because mowing is also a stress. So when you mow a drought stress lawn, it can accentuate this problem. But this is really, it's an irrigation problem. And you can see in this picture, one neighbor was watering their lawn adequately, and the other one is not watering quite as much, maybe not frequently enough, not enough each time they're watering. But in any case, the ascochyta pops up in the lawn that's not receiving enough water. So again, it's mainly a spring and early summer. Once we get consistently warm weather, this disease interestingly seems to go away. And then people just have brown spots in their lawn from the turf going dormant. But very common disease, and we never, ever, ever recommend a fungicide, because the fungicide is not effective in it. If you dig down into where this disease is active, you can always find the turf is growing back. It doesn't kill the roots, doesn't kill the crowns. The grass always grows back from this. It may take it a few weeks, as the following pictures will show. So the next, or maybe a couple pictures, but anyway, the fix for this is almost always figuring out why your irrigation coverage is a problem. It could be low heads, poor pressure, heads not turning, heads are plugged. Something is wrong with irrigation, or just not running your system long enough, not enough minutes. Maybe you switched out your heads from pop-up sprays to rotors, and you're not running the system long enough. There's all kinds of reasons that this disease pops up, but it's always, always because of it's a water issue. And this just shows how quickly a lawn can look bad, but then how quickly it can survive. So you look at and pay attention to the date here. This is June 9th. This is at the near the rec center in Windsor, and where they've got irrigation problems. And then look at this, just 20 days later, with a little bit of rain and maybe fixing the irrigation coverage, the turf recovers. So that wasn't reseeded, it wasn't resodded. That happened just in about 3 weeks. So the turf does recover from this ascochyta, but you have to repair the irrigation problem, or at least hope for some good rain to restore soil moisture in those areas where the coverage is bad. Okay, some tips for reducing water use in lawns. People always want to know, how can I water less? One way is to just reduce run time. So if your lawn is looking good, you don't have brown spots. Instead, you know, if your run times are, let's just say 20 minutes, turn them down to 18. Do that 10% reduction, just a 2 minute reduction in run times. And if your lawn continues to look good, you've just saved 10% of your water. So this is an easy way to reduce water use. It's often painless. Often you don't notice any difference in the quality of the turf. But if you do, then bump it back up from 18 to 19 minutes and see if just that extra 1 minute, and you say, well, that's just 1 minute, but over the course of an entire growing season, that extra 1 minute might be enough to be the difference between brown spots and green spots. So you can change very fine tuning of your irrigation system and actually save a whole lot of water with that fine tuning over an entire growing season. And the other thing is to manually run your system. Just instead of running it every Monday, Wednesday, Friday, run it when the turf seems to need water, put a bunch of water on, and then don't water again until it looks like the turf needs water. This is what people who do hose and sprinkler irrigation do. And then another thing is to get a rain sensor to turn your irrigation system off. If you're not home and your system's running and it's raining, or maybe you're irrigating at night and you get a rainstorm during the night, it'll turn your system off. So you're taking advantage of the rain and not applying unnecessary amounts of water. Another thing you can do is switch your sprinkler heads from these pop-up sprays, which run, you know, if you run them effectively, they can be okay. But generally they put water on very fast, and in fact, too fast for the soil to absorb it. So then we get puddling, or even worse, it runs off into the street or on the sidewalks or into low spots in your lawn. That's where you end up with brown spots and green spots. They just apply water too fast for our soil conditions in Colorado. So by switching those pop-up sprays to rotors, which is that middle type, and these are the heads that turn in a circle very, very slowly. They put water on slowly, and that can be a way to get better water infiltration. And then that, incidentally, can lead to more efficient and more uniform watering of your lawn. And the other option, which is a really easy one, is to replace those pop-up sprays with the stream rotors. And this is simply unscrewing the old pop-up spray and finding a similar brand. It's easiest to go from Toro to Toro, Rainbird to Rainbird, Hunter to Hunter heads. But and all the irrigation companies have these stream rotors, these fingers of water type spray heads. Those are very efficient sprinkler heads, and they put water out very slowly and very uniformly. So it can turn kind of a marginal irrigation system of pop-up sprays to a pretty efficient irrigation system simply by changing out those type of heads or spray tips. Actually, you don't even have to change the head. You're not digging or anything. You're just unscrewing one and screwing the other one in. And many water conservation departments and cities will give you rebates if you save the receipts on doing that. Okay. let's transition here to a little bit on veggies. Really some of the problems that we saw in lawns with the brown spots, it was dry and it was hot, translated to sometimes problems in our vegetable gardens. So if you look at the that temperature curve through last growing season, notice all those peaks above the average, and how many times during basically spring, June, July, August, into the fall, our temperatures were way above average in Colorado. That can be good for plants to grow, but it may not necessarily be good for those plants to produce fruit. And so we saw problems with fruit production in things like tomatoes, cucumbers, peppers. When it gets too hot, we don't get really good pollination. When it gets too hot, people oftentimes aren't irrigating frequently enough. So for vegetables, uniform irrigation, and by uniform, it's sometimes as daily, especially if you're doing stuff in containers, and it may be even twice daily. If you've got a large plant in a small container, like a large tomato in a small container, you may have to irrigate that plant in that container twice daily to keep its root system uniformly moist. But that lack of uniformity in watering can lead to poor pollination, poor fruit set. It can lead to bitter fruit in the case of especially things like cucumbers. It can lead to cat facing and splitting. It can lead to blossom end rot, which people think that's just a tomato problem. But actually, blossom end rot can happen on cucumbers. It can happen on peppers. So you get kind of misshapen fruit. So if you had those problems this past summer, a lot of times it could be attributed to non-uniform watering with those vegetables, and attributed to our really high temperatures, which are kind of hard to deal with. But we'll show you some pictures of how to deal with that. The other problem with fruit set and even the sweetness and flavor of fruit on these veggies is that when it gets really hot, photosynthesis doesn't function as uniformly. So we get less sugar production sometimes, and sugars are again what makes vegetables taste good. And when it gets too hot, the plants are using sugars just to survive, and they may not put as much sugar into the production of their fruit. So that can be a problem with the flavor of the fruit. Plus, the plants are just using that energy to survive under those higher temperatures. They're respiring, and they're exerting a lot of energy just to stay alive. And so less sugar, less energy goes into fruit production. So your fruit may not be as large or as sweet as it might be if it was a little bit cooler temperatures, a little bit more moderate. So something you can do, and that has to do with nighttime temperatures too. So when nighttime temperatures stay high, respiration stays high. So you're kind of burning the candle at both ends. So one of the nice things usually about Colorado is we can get down into those maybe low 50 degrees at night, and that gives plants a little bit of relief. But when it's like high 50s or even into the 60s at night, sometimes the plants are a little more stressed, even if they are warm season plants like corn and our melons and our peppers and our tomatoes. So, but certainly the cold season crops like broccoli and spinach, they don't like those warm nighttime temperatures, and that those plants get bitter too, and they start bolting. And so high temperatures are not really good there. So one way to mitigate this is to use shade cloth to shade your plants. This can help with sun scald, which is oftentimes a problem with tomatoes and peppers especially, but you can even get this on squash that are exposed to where they don't have enough leaves covering those developing fruit. But certainly tomatoes, where that one big tomato is in the sun, and it's basically it's getting sunburned just like you would. So if your tomatoes don't have a lot of leaf cover for those developing fruit, you can get sun scald on those. And same thing with peppers on the shoulders of your peppers. Using the shade cloth over your tomatoes, over your peppers, even over a squash. We see a lot of our vegetable growers now, they grow squash even in high tunnels to provide a little bit of shading for them. That just helps with production. You get better pollination. It keeps them a little bit cooler. You can prolong your broccoli. Green beans are really cool season plants. And so they might produce a little bit better with a little bit of shading. It's just that our sun is so extreme, as we know why we wear sunscreen in Colorado. So this shade cloth can really help. And plus it can double, if you put it up properly, it can double as hail cloth. And in fact, that's what I do in my garden is I use hail cloth, which doubles as a shade cloth for my garden. And I put it over everything to protect against hail and to help the vegetables produce a little bit better. So one curious thing, and Allison found this, is that when cucumbers and all the cucurbits, the squash, everything in this family, when they are produced or growing under drought or inconsistent watering, they develop this bitter taste. This is a survival mechanism. It's an antithedent. This will discourage critters from feeding on that fruit, and that's what allows the seed to mature. It will also deter us from feeding on them because it will taste really terrible to us. So again, this is a product of inconsistent watering, this bitterness. So again, very uniform watering is the key to preventing bitter flavors and tastes in your cucumbers and your squash and those type of things. Something else also, though, if you're a seed saver and you do happen to produce these bitter fruit, but then you get into cross pollination and you save those seeds and you plant them next year, your offspring, even if they're well cared for, they may be some bitterness to those plants. So that's just a little hint if you're a seed saver to make sure you're doing using good watering practices so you don't want that next crop from those seeds to be more bitter. Okay, I think that's all we have on veggies. Oh no, one more little thing. So just to summarize, consistent soil moisture. Use shade cloth if you can, and it doubles as hail cloth. You know, don't over fertilize. You can get a lot of green growth and not much fruit production. So fertilize very reasonably and sparingly and at the right time in the growth cycle of those plants. And, if it's hot and you don't use shade cloth, don't be surprised if you don't get good pollination. So just putting in a pitch for shade cloth there, it can really surprisingly help you get some better vegetables. So give it a try. Al's turn here.
All right. Thanks, Tony. Amy, were there any questions Tony needed to answer before we do the pass off?
We got them all.
Okay.
As far as I know.
All right. Let's move on to a couple tree issues, or really one major tree issue that we saw. I have a feeling, I have a sneaking suspicion that we're going to see more tree problems in 2023 because of the drought and the dryness that we had. But one that came across my desk quite a bit, and I know that the tree teamers in Larimer County saw probably more often than they had in years past, is Ips beetle. And this may or may not be an insect that you're familiar with. It tends to be an insect on our evergreens. And in the urban front range, where we see Ips tends to be on mature spruce. So if you are in an older neighborhood or you have a location like this cemetery in Berthoud where you have these really old large spruce, they tend to be the ones that are most susceptible. And it is a stress-related insect. And so it is one that comes in, it's an opportunist that comes in terms of dry conditions, drought conditions, and things like that. We do have three different types of IPS that we have in Colorado. So there's IPS pinii, that is going to be on our pine trees for the most part. Hunteri is the one that hits the spruce, and then Confucius is the one that can be on pinyons. So we have seen them actually jump ship from one specific host to others. And so this insect is getting a little, I don't want to say aggressive, but it's becoming more problematic. And I had several calls. I saw several incidences on golf courses this summer where they have big mature spruce. And so this is one that if you have a spruce in your landscape, cultural care practices, making sure that that tree is watered well all season is really big. That's going to be your biggest thing that you can do. So the signs and symptoms, we did talk about this last year as a problem. And because of the hot, dry, droughty summer, we did continue to see issues. So IPS are bark beetles that feed under the bark and into the cambium. And so they are cambium feeding insects. And so they basically disrupt the movement of the water and nutrients up and down the trunk itself. So we do see some of that tunneling and girdling that can happen. One of the signs that you might see if you have IPS or if you have a large mature spruce are these kind of like reddish sawdust patches that are in the bark itself. The other thing is that damage tends to start at the top of the tree and then work its way down. So you might see some browning at the top, and this is where it gets really difficult. So Tony talked about having to ID turf issues and having them mimic each other. This is another one. So browning at the top could be just, you know, winter desiccation. It could be drought stress. It could be something other than a biological insect, but it is really difficult. And if these are really big, large trees, you can't see the top of the canopy. So having an arborist that you trust, someone that might be able to come in and take a look with a bucket truck, is going to be a good thing for you. So again, that damage starts at the top and moves its way down. It tends to happen rather quickly. And it is recommended that if you do have IPS beetles or damage to your property, that you remove that tree, because those IPS can then fly to other species. And so doing your due diligence in getting rid of infested material is going to be really important. There are some insecticides, and this is an area that people are looking into, potential trunk injections and things like that. Really, this is where you have a conversation with a trusted arborist. If these are signature trees of your property, these are trees that you want to maintain and have treatment for IPS or other issues like mountain pine beetle, things like that. If you have an immediate outbreak in your neighborhood, that's where you would then start treating. If you're kind of an island, you haven't had a lot of issues, the Forest Service hasn't issued any sort of FYIs, or you haven't heard it from city bulletins, things like that, probably you don't need to. But here in Fort Collins, we've seen some outbreaks both on the northern part of town, down in Berthoud too, so in Larimer County, kind of in the mid part of Fort Collins. And then I did hear from some colleagues in Grand Junction where IPS are also a prevalent problem. So just be aware that they're out there and it's something to take notice of. So these are Amy's pictures. This was at the Berthoud Cemetery last year, but you can see some of that orangish red sawdust. It's not super noticeable. So this is where you do that macro inspection of your tree and the bark to see. At this point, you would probably see decline from the top down. So you would start to see kind of that browning that's occurring. And if you're seeing this at eye level, more than likely that tree is pretty far gone. So scouting is number one. You cannot be too vigilant enough, especially with your own landscape. IPS are teeny tiny, itty bitty. So this is a penny. You can see Lincoln's nose right there in his chin. Here is a mature IPS beetle, and you can see how small they are. So one of our renowned entomologists, Dave Leatherman, actually sent this out on our pest serve earlier this summer about how many IPS can a spruce have? And it was fascinating. So he took a section of tree, and this was from a tree at City Park in Fort Collins, and it was about a half a square foot. So it measured 12 by 6. That sample, he reared it out because this is what entomologists do. They love doing things even in retirement. He reared out and then counted the number of beetles that came out of that bark sample, and he counted 128 beetles. Then he went and looked at the mature tree, measured, you know, the diameter of the tree, estimated what the total bark square footage would be. And that one tree had an approximate 70,000 beetles that could potentially emerge from that. And as you know, with these bark feeding insects or these bark beetles, they then move to other trees where they then infect them, lay eggs, and complete their life cycle. So that is why if you had a tree in decline or potentially in decline from IPS, that is why getting rid of infestations are so, so, so critical. So just be aware of that. So IPS is one that we should keep on the lookout for. If you have those old mature evergreens, those spruce, water is going to be essential. And I've had several conversations with colleagues about spruce. It's a strange tree because it is a native species, right? Colorado spruce, we have spruce everywhere. And it is not very tolerant to drought stress in the urban landscape. And so where we see declines is people making adjustments to their lawn irrigation, but they might have a spruce there, or changes in how we water. And spruce, for the most part, do not adjust well to differences in irrigation. So I would say they're not a drought tolerant species, especially if for most of their life, they have been used to getting routine, regular irrigation. So spruce are one, they tend to have a more shallow root system. And again, they don't adjust well to those periods of drought. So year-round regular moisture is important. If you're going to focus on winter watering, you're going to focus on your mature spruce. That is what you should do. And then you can consider using insecticides if you're in one of those hot spot areas. At the Berthoud Cemetery, all of these trees were removed starting last summer, and I think they went into this summer as well. And it's just really a shame. These are beautiful old trees, and they did not have another solution. They don't really have a way to water them as well. It could have been a good year for grasshoppers, good or bad. It depends on how you look at it, but they really socked a punch to us in some aspects. And so depending on where you lived, it may have been a good year for grasshoppers. There were some reports of significant damage. At our farmer's market in Old Town, probably we had at least 5 or 6 questions every week about grasshopper damage. Now, here's the thing, is we all know that grasshoppers have those big mandibles where they can cause significant damage to your plants. But this is where I think doing a check on if they're causing significant damage that is catastrophic or detrimental to your garden. That's what you need to remember. So grasshoppers might chew all the leaves of your iris. But if your iris have already bloomed, it makes them look bad. But does that warrant control? So going back to the fundamentals of IPM is first identifying what caused the damage. And if you see a grasshopper chewing on something, you've identified the pest. And then understand the life cycle. So as grasshoppers get larger and bigger, as the summer goes along, they are far, far more difficult, if not impossible, to control. So again, it's scouting very early and getting an idea of if it's going to be a good grasshopper year or not. And then what you need to do is really balance that with your action threshold. What does it take for you to do something, for you to spray, for you to do some preventative measures, or to control the problem? So what is your tolerance for injury? Grasshoppers in your vegetable garden where they're yielding food that you're going to eat is very different than grasshoppers potentially in the ornamental landscape. So that's where you need to look at things. So grasshopper on the left, maybe on your tomatoes. We had some other issues, it appears, with some flea beetle injury on that one versus grasshopper on your coneflower. Now, if you're growing coneflowers for cut flower production, or you sell them at the farmer's market, or you plan to enter the county fair, that is a very different thing than just having coneflowers in the landscape. But that is something to consider. I think we jump the gun and get a little too excited about trying to control something when we don't look at the system as a whole. Now, if the grasshoppers are so bad that they're actually eating your window screens, And there have been years, I've been told, I haven't been in Colorado where this has happened, but they have been so bad where they have eaten window screens. Okay, that absolutely is your threshold of control right there. I think it was Tony who told me they actually ate a baseball glove. I don't know. It's out of control. I'm thinking like the locusts and those like horrible insects that came through and ate everything. But again, they can be very bad, but a few grasshoppers here and there may not be as big of an issue. Here's the thing with grasshopper biology. Our winter will really determine if it's going to be a good year for grasshoppers or not. So a lot of the eggs are going to be laid in the fall in dry, undisturbed areas. So if you are in a neighborhood that has a lot of open space or maybe agricultural fields or things like that, that's more likely a place for the grasshoppers to lay their eggs. So dry, exposed winters, and especially if they're cold, the hope is that some of those eggs will not survive. Okay, so hope for that. Then the eggs hatch in the spring in the nymphs. So grasshoppers have incomplete metamorphosis. So the little guys look like the big guys. What the nymphs do is then seek immediate vegetation around them. So they will look for cheatgrass or other sources of early season food. When that food runs out, that's when then the grasshoppers come to our lawns and landscapes. And so depending on how much weed there is, how much vegetation there is in the area is really going to determine if they're going to move into more urban areas. And as those plants dry up in the heat of summer, this is what happens. A fun fact for you is that those lady grasshoppers right now are laying their eggs or have laid their eggs, and they can lay up to 400 at a time. So go lady grasshoppers. So what do you do? Besides employing the use of turkeys, which are probably the best grasshopper hunters that you could have, if you have access to a flock of turkeys, you could bring them into your home landscape. I have some chickens. They do enjoy the grasshoppers, I will say, but turkeys are the best control. And this is actually an old photo of a turkey farm that was used to control grasshoppers. So the big thing is use your crystal ball to predict whether or not it's going to be a good grasshopper year. There are actually people, entomologists, who can look at this and offer options if it's going to be good or bad. If it's going to be a dry winter, more than likely the eggs may not survive. If we have snow cover and moisture, which we desperately need as gardeners, it could encourage those grasshopper eggs to survive. The big thing is that you really have to be Johnny on the spot and treat for these early when the grasshoppers are young. So the younger they are in those nymph stages, the easier they are to control. At the end of summer, when they're huge and they're, you know, 3 inches long, that is not the time to control them. They become more mobile, they're harder to kill. And so when they're small is key. Options you could consider are no-low bait. You can also use some contact insecticides if populations are that high, then you can get your turkeys. No-low bait is pretty cool. There was a gap in finding it because the factory in, I believe it was Durango, had a fire and it, you know, burned the facility down, but production is back. I went to their website and they have stopped producing for 2022, but they will be producing in 2023. So that's a good thing. This is an organic control option for grasshoppers. It's a fungi that's been planted on bran flakes. And so the grasshoppers eat the bran flakes, which is then laced with this fungi. And essentially what it does, it's kind of a cool process. It causes the grasshoppers to stop feeding and kind of introduces like really a bad stomach ache, which then turns fatal. So it's kind of an interesting thing of how it works. So it's planted on wheat bran. It's also sold as semaspore. So you might see no-low bait or semaspore. Those are two things. And you can always buy it online and a lot of local places will carry it too. The thing is, the younger they are, the better it is. So this is where when grasshoppers, when you start to see those nymphs, and they're little, they're tiny, that's when you need to start putting this bait out into your landscape. And it is not fast acting. It is not something that you put out and you see dead grasshoppers all over the next day. We're talking maybe 1 to 3 weeks, if not an entire season. So that's something to consider. The fun fact is that the ailing grasshoppers who have ingested the no-low bait and they're suffering, they have the worst stomach ache of their life, they're going to die. They are then cannibalized by healthy grasshoppers who then eat the sick grasshoppers, and then the healthy ones also get the no-low bait into their bodies too. So it's kind of a cool process of how it works. So, but no-low bait can be effective. To wrap it up, it was an amazing year for fall color. I don't think anyone predicted this, but basically we had such a nice, leisurely long fall with sunny, warm days that it was absolutely incredible. Some of the best fall color I've ever seen in my 17 years of being here in Colorado. I would say it gave Minnesota a run for its money too. So we had those long days, which didn't quite stop chlorophyll production, but the trees were getting signals that the days were getting shorter. So chlorophyll production ceased, those sugars concentrated, and then we got these amazing fall colors that then expressed themselves in the leaves. And so just a couple things, make sure you're out there with your fall and winter watering, great for trees, great for your lawn, great for anything that you planted this fall. Make sure to do that on days above 40 degrees. And don't apply any water if there's snow or ice on the ground itself. And pull out that hose and sprinkler. Don't turn on your irrigation. I'll skip that. It's a good time to clean and sharpen your tools. If your tools get neglected all year like mine do, and they're filled with soil and other bits and bobs, give them some love, scrape all that off, get them sharpened. It is amazing what a sharp shovel can do for you as a gardener in the spring, or pay someone to do it. That's also a good thing. You can get on those seed catalog lists. I've heard some of the seed catalogs have already appeared in mailboxes and inboxes across the United States. And so I think it's a little early, but if you love looking at seed catalogs, that's one thing that you can do. And then take some time to sort and organize your seed packet. Seed starting will start in a few months, and it is a good thing to go through, kind of sort through what's maybe old, what's maybe new, what you didn't like that tasted really bad. You could do a quick germination test and put like 10 seeds in a wet paper towel in a warm place and see what the germination is, especially if you have seed that's older than 3 or 5 years. And then organize a seed swap. That's a way for you to get together with friends and neighbors and colleagues as well. So I do want to remind you that on December 14th, we are going to have Eric Hammond here at the Adams County Extension Office talking about evergreens for the landscape. So Amy will put that into the chat. You can register. That will be Wednesday, December 14th at noon Mountain Standard Time. You can always visit the cohort's blog to register for any of our classes. And Amy and I do plan on doing these again next year. And so if you have topics, we'll send out a survey. We'd love to hear from you. What haven't we covered? We've now done this for a couple of years, and so we'd love to know what's on your mind of what we could help inform you better. So with that, 1 o'clock on the nose, I will take any questions that we have.
I know some people have said they haven't planted their bulbs yet for spring. Don't worry, plenty of time. As long as you can dig the ground 6 inches or so deep, you should be in good shape. I haven't planted mine either, so we are all together in this.
I got mine in, but that was, I had a burst of energy.
Yeah, most bulbs are going to require 14 to 16 weeks of chilling time if they're tulips. Daffodils, not so much, maybe, I don't know, 12 to 14 weeks, so we're in good shape, everybody.
Better to plant them than to take the risk of letting them dry out over the winter.
True.
And I would water them in. Yep. When you plant, try to water them in. And then if you can, put some mulch on top, whether that's leaves or bark or whatever you have. Squirrels. I think exclusion is the biggest one. Try fencing, try netting, try, oh, they eat everything. Oh. Oh. Some aggressive squirrels. Tony, anything?
Nothing legal. Well, it depends on where you live. I mean, yeah, really, you can trap, but just check wherever you're living about relocation laws and that kind of thing.
And we didn't mention that, or maybe it was in the chat, but generally if you remove an animal, another one will move into its place, but maybe one that's not quite as hungry as what you're facing. Okay. All right. Well, thanks, everybody. We hope to see you in December. Have a great November and a good holiday season.